Good morning, everyone. Thank you, students, staff, and supporters for attending Young America's Foundation's 38th National Conservative Student Conference. My name is Jim Strife, and I'll be transferring to the University of Utah after having spent 2 years at the University of Miami. I've had the privilege of interning with Young America's Foundation this summer, and we are honored to start the day with one of the most notable activists in the conservative movement. The foundation is dedicated to conservative outreach, striving to inspire America's youth to uphold the conservative ideals that built this country. We use programs like this conference to promote the ideas of individual freedom, free enterprise, a strong national defense, and traditional values to young people across the country. Each year, the foundation succeeds in introducing thousands of people to these ideas through our numerous conferences, internships, campus lectures, Young Americans for Freedom chapters, our Center for Entrepreneurship and Free Enterprise, and the National Journalism Center. In 1998, the foundation stepped forward to save President Ronald Reagan's beloved Rancho del Cielo, the ranch in the sky. His ranch has been fundamental in helping with our ability to pass on his ideas to future generations. For more information on our mission or our programs, you can visit www.yaf.org or call 1-800-USA-1776. Our first speaker today is one of the most distinguished leaders in the conservative movement. Dinesh D'Souza has been at the forefront of the movement for over 25 years as a writer, scholar, and documentary movie producer. A former policy analyst at the Reagan White House, D'Souza also served as John M. Olin Fellow at the American Enterprise Institute and the Robert and Karen Rishwain Fellow at the Hoover Institution at Stanford University. In addition, he served as the president of the King's College in New York City from 2010 to 2012. In 1995, D'Souza published The End of Racism, which became one of the most controversial books of the time and a national bestseller. His 1997 book, Ronald Reagan, How an Ordinary Man Became an Extraordinary Leader, was the first book to make the case for Reagan's intellectual and political importance. In 2002, D'Souza published his New York Times bestseller, What's So Great About America, which was critically acclaimed for its thoughtful patriotism. His 2003 book, Letters to a Young Conservative, has become a handbook for a new generation of young conservatives inspired by D'Souza's style and ideas. Dinesh stands out among our distinguished spread of incredible speakers this week. Not only has he encountered great success in literature, but also in film. He's managed to infiltrate liberal Hollywood and has produced three of the most successful political documentaries in history. His most recent endeavor, a critically acclaimed documentary that will change the landscape of the news cycle from now until November, launched nationwide on July 15th and has already become the highest grossing documentary of 2016. Now, before we bring Dinesh to the stage, take a look at this.
Who are these Democrats?
It is my judgment.
Dinesh D'Souza was sentenced on Tuesday to spend 8 months in a confinement center.
It all began when the Obama administration tried to shut me up.
You know, gangs are all about stealing, man.
What did I learn?
All crime is about stealing. The big criminals are still at large.
Didn't see any reason to keep them.
The system doesn't go after them. Because they run the system. It's time to go behind the curtain and discover the soul of the Democratic Party.
Yes, yes, yes. 50 lashes.
Ah, no! How does that feel? No! Come on.
The Democrats support slaves.
This Civil Rights Act will allow colored men to sit at the same table beside the white guests.
Tammany Hall Democrats, who are now furnishing arms to the Ku Klux Klan.
To the Democratic Party.
Why has all this been swept under the rug?
To cover the tracks of the Democratic Party.
And we're not even talking about ancient history.
The racism continued well into the 20th century.
That as long as the black man continues to ravish our white women, we will continue to lynch him.
Gotta give them a little something.
plantation politics.
The Democrats went from slavery to enslavement.
Corrupt big city bosses, that's how you get corrupt unions.
What does progressive actually mean?
Social engineering and social control.
That a large family does to one of its infant members is to kill it.
The opening video of the Democratic Convention in 2012, government is the one thing we all belong to. Because no, government belongs to us. We don't belong to it.
What are these Democrats hiding?
This is about buying and selling influence by foreign oligarchs and foreign governments. When you follow the money, there are very, very few coincidences.
What if the goal of the Democratic Party is to steal the most valuable thing the world has ever produced? What if their plan is to steal America? Who will stop them now? Thank you very much. It's for me always an honor and privilege to be here at the Young Americas Foundation Summer Conference. I'm thrilled to be accompanied by my wife, Debbie. We're both immigrants, Debbie from Venezuela and me from India. Whenever I look at you guys, I always think about when I first came to America. I was 17 years old. And I was an exchange student from India, going to a public school in Arizona. And I remember the airplane descending on New York City. And I looked out the window. I saw the skyline of New York. I saw the Statue of Liberty. And kind of a very strange feeling came over me because I realized that my life from that moment on would be totally different. I realized, even without being political, intuitively, that I was moving from the margin of the world to the center. And I realized that I would be able to do things with my life that I would not be able to do if I had stayed back in India. Here in America, I have experienced the American dream, which isn't just a dream of economic success or opportunity. It's really the dream of being able to be the architect of your own destiny. It is the dream of being able to write the script of your own life. And so here in America, if your parents say to you, hey, young Billy, young Jane, what do you want to be when you grow up? They can advise you. But at the end of the day, they know that it is you who will supply the answer to that question. Now, fast forward about 25 years, and it was about a year ago that I found myself locked up in a federal confinement center under the supervision of the Bureau of Prisons of the Obama administration with 120 seasoned hoodlums. I was going to say seasoned hoodlums like myself, but they were certainly seasoned hoodlums. And this was for my crime of exceeding the campaign finance limit. I'd actually given $20,000 to a college friend of mine who was running for the Senate. Normally, this is an offense when there isn't any corruption. You aren't trying to buy favors or do any kind of underhanded dealings. Normally, this is something that's referred to the Federal Election Commission. It's not a criminal matter at all. You get a fine, maybe some community service. But in my case, the Obama administration prosecuted me with the full force of the law, unleashed a battery of FBI agents on me, tried to get my assistant to wear a hidden wire as if I was, you know, Al Capone. And there I was in a federal courtroom hearing a bailiff bark out the phrase, United States of America versus Dinesh D'Souza. Kind of a chilling feeling down your spine when you are an immigrant. Now, did I exceed the campaign finance law? Yes. But no American has been locked up for doing what I did. In fact, right about the same time that my case was migrating through the courts, another guy, this fellow's name was Sant Chatwal, Asian Indian guy. We Asian Indians appear to specialize in the campaign finance violations area. In any event, this dude gave $180,000 in straw donations to Hillary Clinton and a group of other Democratic candidates. He was also found guilty of witness tampering, and he openly boasted about his corruption, about trying to buy these politicians. This guy gets no prison, no confinement. So I mentioned this because justice is not simply a matter of, did you break the law? Justice is also a matter of, does the penalty fit the crime? Did other guys who did the same thing get roughly the same penalty? I think we can see from my case that the progressive justice that I was subjected to was a sham. That this was actually a kind of selective prosecution. Now, why do I think that? Because just a few months earlier, I had made the film 2016 Obama's America, in which I kind of got not only into Obama's world, but I also got into Obama's head. And people say, well, gee, Dinesh, what makes you think that the President of the United States, a relatively busy man, would care what you did? Well, the reason I know that he did is because right after the film came out, vituperative attacks on me in the movie began to appear on a website called BarackObama.com. And these attacks were unsigned, but if you actually read them closely, in their peculiar mixture of arrogance, incoherence, pomposity, one could recognize the unmistakable signature of the man who currently occupies the White House. So, this was why I found myself in federal confinement, a confinement center. Now, initially, I was kind of jubilant. The Obama administration actually wanted to lock me up to 2 years. By the way, had they succeeded, there's no way I could have made this movie on Hillary. In fact, I would be locked up now. But instead, I got this 8-month confinement center in which I would spend the nights in a dorm about the size of this room with 120 other guys who had served prison sentences. And these weren't white-collar guys. There were maybe 5 to 8 white-collar criminals. The rest of them were drug smugglers, coyotes, armed robbers, rapists, the whole gamut of very rough guys. And initially, I was kind of terrified because I thought to myself, well, first of all, the majority were Hispanic, but everybody seemed to be in some group or gang. And the gangs were complex. I mean, even the Hispanics weren't in one gang. The American Hispanics, who are called Southsiders, had their own gangs. And then the Mexicans had their gangs. So I'm like, man, I can't talk to this guy because that guy's going to want to kill me. So, I mean, I did consider starting my own gang, the Asian Indian gang. But after about a month, I thought to myself, look, I'm in a strange place. I'm sort of like an anthropologist in a strange land. And this is not a place where you normally find conservatives, right? I mean, I'm not going to walk down the hall and see Charles Krauthammer or George Will. So I said, let me talk to these guys and kind of learn the ideology of the criminal underclass. Now, my previous exposure to this ideology was limited to 2 viewings of The Shawshank Redemption, in which I had the idea that all criminals insist that they never did it. They're totally innocent. But in talking to these guys over a period of many weeks, I realized that their view is somewhat different and more interesting. Their view is, we did it. We're guilty. But we are the stupid criminals. We're the guys who got caught. That's why we're here. We are also the small fry. The big fry never get caught. The big fry are out there. And in fact, the big fry aren't even pursued by the system because they run the system. They have connections within the system that protect them. And so this got me thinking. Because for 25 years, I've looked at American politics as a kind of debate. We are the conservatives, and we believe this, and the liberals believe that, and the Republicans are for equality of rights, and the Democrats are for equality of outcomes, and blah, blah, blah. It is the view of the criminal underclass that this whole way of thinking about American politics is total and complete nonsense. Why? Because human nature isn't motivated that way. Human nature is not motivated by an urge to debate. Human beings are actually motivated by acquisitiveness and greed and lust and rage and anger and hatred and revenge. And if these motives actually drive human life, why should politics be immune or exempt? In other words, we need a wider angle of vision to see politics in its full motive. A motive that is not merely idealistic, but also realistic. Why do people do what they do? Why do the Clintons do what they do? What motivates Obama? So I'd like to talk about that briefly this morning. I'll begin by talking a little bit about the Democratic Party. Now, I'm a creature of the Reagan Revolution, and in fact, Reagan used to say in the 80s, I didn't leave the Democratic Party, it left me. It left me. Now, you get the idea from this that the Democratic Party was actually a good party. And it was actually humming along pretty well until maybe the late 60s or the McGovern campaign, when it kind of went off the rails. It left him. But I regret to say that this is one area where, in a way, Reagan was wrong. And what I mean by that is, in adult life, later, as I began to dig into this subject and began to research it, I began to realize that, no, the Democratic Party has actually had a sordid strain that has defined this party from the very beginning. From the very beginning. And the reason we don't know about it, I didn't know about it, Reagan didn't know about it, is because of the success of progressive historiography. The progressives have been ingenious at covering their tracks. And I'll start by giving a small example of this because it actually pertains to one of the really horrific events of the 20th century, the Holocaust. So in the 1930s, the Democratic Party was fascinated not only by fascism, but also by Nazism. They liked it. And if this seems a little unbelievable, young John F. Kennedy went to Nazi Germany in the 30s and came back super excited about Hitler. In fact, full of praise of Hitler. He called him a legend. He goes, there are people who don't like Hitler, but they're jealous of him. He said the Nazis claim to be superior. They claim that the Nordic people are better than everybody else. And he goes, that's because they are. That's because they are. This is JFK. And by the way, I should tell you that nothing I'm about to say this morning is controversial in the sense of it's debated whether it occurred. You can actually Google JFK Nazi Germany 1930s on your phone, and in 30 seconds you'll see that what I just said to you is true. FDR was enamored by Mussolini. FDR actually dispatched members of his brain trust to go to Italy to study Italian fascism, because he thought Italian fascism was more progressive than the New Deal. And he thought that he could import ideas from Italian fascism here to America. This was not a one-way fascination. It was actually a mutual admiration society. Mussolini reviewed FDR's book in an Italian magazine. He loved it. He goes, my conclusion upon reading this book is this guy is one of us. He's a fascist. This is Mussolini. Now, after World War II, progressive historians looked at all this and they went, whoa. Fascism now carries the odor of the Holocaust, the gas chambers, Dachau. We can't have this kind of stuff in the textbooks. Young people may find out about it. Let's make sure we prudently leave it out. We're not going to lie about it. We're just not going to say anything about it.
So this is a small but telling example of a way in which two of the great progressive figures of the 20th century, JFK and FDR, have been, you may say, protected by the progressive left. Let's continue with FDR for a moment, because FDR, when he was elected, wanted to push through the New Deal. But it was difficult to push through the New Deal because he needed the support of other Democrats. And the Democratic Party in FDR's time was racist to the core. Racist to the core. FDR needed the racist Democrats to get the New Deal through. So he goes to the racist Democrats and he basically says, please support the New Deal. I'll give you all kinds of benefits. We'll build the Tennessee Valley Project in your neighborhood and so on. But the racist Democrats said, that's not enough. We'll vote for the New Deal if you, FDR, agree to block all anti-lynching laws that are proposed by the Republicans. FDR agrees. The racist Democrats say, in addition to that, we want to make sure that the two main occupations that blacks are in, namely domestic service and agricultural labor, are excluded from most New Deal programs. No New Deal for blacks. FDR agrees again. So here is the progressive hero of the 20th century completely in bed with the worst racists in America who were a critical part of getting his New Deal through. Once again, this is a fact. A fact. Now, let's back up and take in the big picture, because the big picture can be summarized as follows. The Democratic Party, who founded it? Right away, that's kind of a mystery. Who started this Democratic Party? We know that Abraham Lincoln was kind of the founder of the Republican Party. Who started the Democratic Party? Well, people say, well, maybe it was FDR. No, it can't be FDR. There was a Democratic Party in the 19th century. People say, maybe it was Thomas Jefferson. No, it wasn't Jefferson. Jefferson's party was called the Democratic Republican Party. And it split and later became the Democratic Party, later the Republican Party. So Andrew Jackson was the founder of the Democratic Party. Now, Andrew Jackson is a controversial figure. He's controversial because of his Indian wars. He was known as kind of a savage Indian fighter. But I want to highlight a side of Andrew Jackson that is never talked about. There are whole biographies on Andrew Jackson that never mention this. And that is Andrew Jackson as somebody who figured out how to profit greatly from public policy. Profit from public policy. So here's what Jackson would do. He would be getting ready to have a fight with the Indians and drive them off their land and push them further west. And the whole idea was that this land would then be auctioned off to settlers. But since Andrew Jackson knew which land was going to become available, before the fight, he would send in his private surveyors who would determine the value of that land, which would then be reported privately to him. He would then contact his buddies who were investors, and those guys would bid on the land before it even became available for sale. In fact, they would bid on the land before the Indians had even been thrown off the land. In this way, Andrew Jackson went from, to use a phrase from Hillary Clinton, dead broke, to becoming one of the richest men in the country. He was worth, in today's money, over $100 million. And he took this money and he bought himself a big slave plantation in Tennessee. Now, why do I tell you this? Because the roots of the Clinton Foundation can be found in the land-stealing policies of Andrew Jackson. The stuff that we see today, in which the Clintons are able to, you may say, market policy. Think for a moment about the Clintons, if I can fast forward a little bit here. The Clintons, well, Hillary was derided for saying she was dead broke, but it is true, the Clintons didn't come into politics with money. We've had presidents who were rich, FDR was rich, JFK was rich, but they were rich before. The Clintons came into politics and they didn't have a whole lot of money. So how do you go from zero to $300 million on a government salary? How do you do that? How does your foundation accumulate a total of $3 billion when you haven't done anything. You didn't invent the iPhone. You didn't start a business. How do you do that? Is there even a plausible way to imagine how that could legitimately occur? No. No. In other words, what we're dealing with here is crookery. We're dealing with people who have learned how to market policy for private benefit. Now, back to the Democratic Party, so I can lay a context for this. The Democratic Party began not only as the party of Indian relocation, but as the party of slavery. This requires a moment's explanation because clearly Democrats didn't invent slavery. Slavery has been around since the dawn of mankind. What the Democrats invented is something called the positive good school of slavery. In other words, the Democrats invented the idea that slavery is good not merely for the master, but also for the slave. This is kind of unbelievable. Historically, people who defended slavery, like Aristotle, said slavery is a function of regrettable necessity. There's dirty work to be done, someone has to do it, that's why we have slaves. The Democrats came up with the idea that slavery benefits the slave. And I say this because there is an echo today in the way that Democrats run what I'm going to call urban plantations on the same rationale. Our urban plantations benefit the people who live on those plantations. This is an echo of the pro-slavery argument of the 19th century. Now, the Democrats defended slavery consistently, and the Civil War is understood better as a fight, not between the North and the South, but between the pro-slavery Democratic Party and the anti-slavery Republican Party. We think of the Civil War as a North-South fight. And amazingly, this way of thinking about it is itself a triumph of progressive historiography. The progressives took their own crimes, the crimes of the Democratic Party, and said, let's blame the South. Let's get it off ourselves by making the South the bad guy. Let's make the Civil War the anti-slavery North and the pro-slavery South. But right away, if you pause, you think, wait a minute, did most Southerners own slaves? No. 3/4 of the people who fought on the Confederate side in the Civil War did not own a slave. By the same token, the Northern Democrats protected slavery with the same aggressive enthusiasm as the Southern Democrats. So slavery wasn't a Southern thing. The Northern Democrats were covering for it too. So right away you see that the North-South divide, the South did secede. I'm not denying that. But I'm saying that the actual argument was between the two parties. After slavery, the Democratic Party was in a funk. They had lost their biggest stealing project. And I say stealing project because slavery is theft. Slavery is theft. Lincoln called it, you work, I eat. You're stealing a man's labor for his whole life. After slavery, the Democrats came up with some new stuff. Segregation, Jim Crow, lynching, and the Ku Klux Klan. Those are 4 landmark Democratic Party policies after slavery. Now again, it may seem like, well, Dinesh is exaggerating a little bit, segregation. Well, wait a minute. Every segregation law, without exception, was passed by a Democratic legislature and signed by a Democratic governor. There is no exception to this rule. The Klan was founded by Nathan Bedford Forrest, a delegate to the Democratic National Convention. And for 30 years, the Ku Klux Klan served as the domestic terrorist arm of the Democratic Party. This is not my way of putting it. The progressive historian Eric Foner, I'm quoting him from one of his books on Reconstruction. The Klan, in fact, had a revival in the early 20th century on account of Woodrow Wilson, who showed a pro-Ku Klux Klan movie in the White House called Birth of a Nation. That revived the Klan, not only in the South, but also in the Midwest and the West. In the 20th century, the Democrats became the party of forced sterilization, eugenics, and social Darwinism. And later, progressivism became It metamorphosed into a new kind of scam. Now, I mentioned earlier about fascism and how the progressives covered their tracks. The great genius of progressive historiography has been to take the crimes of the Democratic Party and blame them on the South, or the Republican Party, or America. You saw this with Cory Booker a couple of days ago in Philadelphia. He goes, America was responsible for slavery and segregation and Jim Crow, etc., etc. No, America wasn't responsible for those things. If America did those things, they'd still be going on. Some Americans did those things and other Americans stopped them. So who did them? The Democrats. The Democratic Party did. So the genius of progressive storytelling is to take all the bad stuff that we did and blame it on America. And then present yourself as the solution to it. It's kind of like poisoning the well and then showing up claiming to be the water commissioner. Now, how can anybody get away with this? How can you pull off an intellectual scam of this magnitude that is so comprehensive that you can even fool Reagan and Dinesh and a whole bunch of other people? How do you pull this off? Basically, you need to control three institutions: academia, Hollywood, and the media. Those are the three biggest megaphones of our culture. And if you dominate those, there's a whole bunch of propaganda that you can put out, and there's no one around with a voice loud enough to say different. In fact, your propaganda is so successful that even the people who are your opponents believe it and come to accept it. The Democrats are kind of like lawyers who make a legal defense. The first line of the defense is, my client was nowhere on the scene of the crime. This is pure denial. But then when evidence is produced that your client was unmistakably on the scene of the crime, you go, yes, my client was on the scene of the crime, but he didn't own a gun. And then when you provide irrefutable evidence that not only did he own a gun, but he actually pulled the trigger, the Democrats then go, yes, but that was in self-defense. So the last line of Democratic defense against this indictment, which is irrefutable when they're absolutely up against the wall, is called the big switch. The big switch. The most important intellectual task done by this movie, Hillary's America, and my accompanying book of the same title, is to debunk and destroy the myth of the big switch. So what's the big switch? The basic idea is, well, gee, now that you've kind of got the goods on us, we admit that we did all this bad stuff, but just kind of at the last minute, we changed. We Democrats saw the light and became the good guys, and all the racists became Republicans. This is the big switch. Now, this is a very cunning argument, because on the surface, it appears to be supported by two momentous facts. The first fact is that blacks who used to vote Republican do in fact vote Democrat. And so this would seem to support the idea there must have been some kind of a switch. Don't blacks know who their friends are? Don't blacks realize today that their friends are the Democrats? Why else would they switch? Number two, Southern whites who used to be monolithically Democratic have now in fact become largely Republican. So that too appears to corroborate the notion of the big switch. I want to tell you why the big switch is a big lie. First of all, let's start with blacks. Blacks did switch, but not because of race. When did blacks switch from being Republicans to being Democrats? Blacks switched during the era of the New Deal. The New Deal. Why? Because their conditions were economically desperate. Essentially, they were bribed into doing it. The blacks who switched knew that they were leaving the party of Lincoln and emancipation and joining the party of segregation and the Ku Klux Klan. But they did it anyway. Now, I don't blame them because conditions in the Depression were terrible. But long term, this has proven to be a really bad deal for blacks. I'll come to that in a minute. I now want to turn to Southern whites. When did whites switch from the Democratic Party to the Republican Party? They actually switched between the 1970s and the 1990s. Why? The reason that Southern whites switched is not because of racism, but it was because of the decline of racism. In other words, if you look at survey data, you can see that racism is declining dramatically in the South in the second half of the 20th century. So as the South becomes less racist, it becomes more Republican. You can just chart those two things and you can see that there's an inverse connection between, as racism goes down in the South, the Republicanism of the South becomes stronger. In other words, the Republican Party won over the non-racists in the South who identified with patriotism, economic opportunity, and social conservatism, Christianity. Now, did the racist Dixiecrats in the South become Republicans? Answer, no. The whole case that claims a big switch relies on one guy, Strom Thurmond. Strom Thurmond was a Dixiecrat. He did become a Republican, but he was pretty much the only one. You can make a list of dozens, if not hundreds, of racist Dixiecrats. You can do this very easily yourself, and you will see the vast, vast majority of them remained in the Democratic Party. They felt more comfortable in the party of bigotry than they would in the Republican Party. This is a fact. So the big switch is bogus. Well, but didn't Richard Nixon have a Southern strategy? No. Richard Nixon did not have a Southern strategy, and if he had a Southern strategy, it didn't work, because the Deep South went for Wallace. Wallace is the guy whose slogan was segregation today, segregation tomorrow, segregation forever. I don't have to tell you that Wallace was a Democrat. He carried the Deep South, not Nixon. Now, this may all seem like I'm fighting about history, but it's very important history. Why? Because the moral capital of the Democratic Party comes from the idea that the Democratic Party are the good guys. They're the good guys. They've always been the good guys. They've always been fighting for the little guy and the ordinary man. They've been fighting for immigrants and Latinos and blacks. In fact, the Democratic Party is the deadly enemy of the ordinary guy. They have been an anti-immigrant party from the beginning. They have been the enslavers and segregators and tormentors and lynchers and murderers of blacks. And you might say, well, but what about today? What about today? So I was in Philadelphia a couple days ago, kind of trolling the Democratic convention. And then I decided to take a walk, and about a mile away, you see a very interesting sight, a real contrast with the glitz of the convention. And that site is, I'm going to call it the Urban Plantation. The Urban Plantation. Now, this may seem like a little bit, Dinesh, you know, you're being a little bit strong here. Plantations. Are you comparing the old slave plantation to what's happening in inner city Philadelphia? Actually, yes. Let's look at the features of the old slave plantation. I'm going to mention five. And I draw this from the historian Kenneth Stamp in his book on the plantation called The Peculiar Institution. So Kenneth Stamp points out that on the old slave plantation, we had ramshackle dwellings. In other words, rundown living quarters called slave quarters, number one. Number two, a family structure in complete disarray. Obviously, children could be bought and sold under slavery, so the family structure was in ruin, a lot of illegitimacy on the plantation, mulattoes running around. Number two, family disintegration. Number three, a high degree of violence needed to keep the place intact. Why? Slavery is based on force. You have to force people to work. It's not easy to do that if you don't have whips, if you don't have the display of actual force. Four, everybody has a meager provision. So you basically have food. If you get sick, they call the doctor. You have health care. I don't think they called it Obamacare in those days. But there's no opportunity. Nobody gets ahead. Everybody's stuck where they are, and there is no advancement. No education. And nihilism, hopelessness, despair. So now I ask you, is it not a fact that if we walk today through inner city Oakland, Detroit, Chicago, Philadelphia, Dallas, that you see exactly the same features today? The rural plantation and its characteristics have been transplanted. And this is particularly interesting since the same party, and in effect the same people, are running both. The difference is that in the old days, the Democrats were stealing people's labor, and today, their only interest in these people is their votes. That's all they want, that's all that they care about, and in fact, they have a vested interest that those people's lives never get better. Never get better. Trillions of dollars have been spent to fix these places. They never get fixed. They're about where they were in 1968. How is this possible? In fact, anytime someone wants to gentrify the inner city, high-tech companies come and go, listen, we're going to create lofts, we're going to create new living spaces, we're going to create high-tech companies, Starbucks will come in, everything will be safe, there'll be a lot of new ladders of opportunity. The progressives fight it tooth and nail. They fight gentrification. Why? Because if you give people ladders of opportunity, they have no further reason to want to be Democrats. And the Democratic Party knows that. So, point I'm trying to make, and I'll kind of wrap it up here, history is not dead. People say, we need to know history so we don't repeat them. No. You need to know history because you're living it. History is with us today. The echoes of the past are in the present. For most of my career, I was a writer and speaker. The reason I've gotten into making movies is movies appeal to the head and the heart. Movies are a way to reach a wider audience. Movies have the potential of recreating and telling stories that people can see and identify with. And yet, if you see the movie and it makes all kinds of extraordinary claims and you go, what? And a lot of people go, what? They're substantiated in my book. So I say in the film, for example, I have this line, which has caused a lot of people's jaws to drop, that in 1860, the year of the Civil War, no Republican owned a slave. None. All the slaves in the entire country were owned by Democrats. And again, people go, are you serious? Is this really true? It is true. The left-wing critics are thrashing around, trying to scream at the movie, scream at the book. They can't find one little fact in the entire movie or the entire book that they can even plausibly dispute, let alone refute. They can't do it. And so they engage in their usual rhetoric. This is paranoid, it's delusional, it's agitprop, blah, blah, blah. It's just a squid-like cloud of empty rhetoric. And me, I love it. I love this stuff because I love seeing my opponents thrashing around helplessly, looking for weapons and not being able to find any. So I urge you, as young people, to learn and to equip yourselves and become very dangerous Americans. To learn and to equip yourselves and become very dangerous Americans. Our times demand it. Normally, we don't need it. In fact, normally, we don't even need to know about the founding that much. We have a great country. It's kind of like your house. You don't need to know the blueprints of your house. You just sleep on the couch, walk in the hallways. It's only when your house begins to shake that you say, hey, I better get up in the attic. I better figure out how this thing was put together. We are living in such a time. And so I want to encourage you to be smart, strategic, creative, and brave. Aristotle says that bravery is the most important courage, the most important of all the virtues, because it takes courage to carry out all the other virtues. And that is very much needed today. Creativity, knowledge, and bravery. And armed with those things, we can help America, we can restore America, we can save America. This has been a very bad Obama period we've been living through. American influence is down. Obama's doubled the national debt. Hillary, I think, is even worse. Hillary, I think, is worse than Obama because Obama is at least ideological. He has a goal. We may not agree with the goal, but his goal is principled. He has a direction he wants to take America, to remake America. The Clintons are Bonnie and Clyde. They've been running rackets since the Arkansas days. When they were in the White House, they were renting out the Lincoln bedroom for money, taking stuff off the walls, later forced to return it, selling pardons to big-time racketeers, felons, and criminals, and then on to the Clinton Foundation. I mean, my gosh. We've had corruption in politics before, Tammany Hall in New York, the Daily Racket in Chicago. We've never had a Secretary of State who's figured out how to make money on foreign policy by collecting money from Canadian billionaires who want mineral rights, by selling out to Russian oligarchs, by intercepting aid money, for God's sake, intended for earthquake relief in Haiti. It doesn't get to Haiti. It gets to the coffers of the Clintons, and Haitians are standing outside the Clinton Foundation. Tell me, Bill, tell me, Hillary, where's the Haiti earthquake money? And this is going on. And the media is not to be seen. Why? Because this is super embarrassing. It's one thing for Democrats to rob from the rich. That's kind of an accomplishment. But robbing from the poor does carry a certain distaste with it. And so progressives decide, just like what I told you about fascism, let's kind of leave that off the news. Let's not highlight that one. It's not going to make our gal look all that good. This is our predicament. This is our time. Our generation, the Reagan generation, is handing the baton to yours. May you be worthy of it. Thank you very much. We have a few minutes for questions, and I'll be delighted to answer. If you're short, I'll be able to take a lot of them. Go for it.
Hi, Dinesh. My name is Stephen Hayes. I go to the University of Colorado. I was wondering, what do you expect Hillary Clinton to focus on in her speech tonight?
Tonight, I think Hillary will focus on the fact that the Democrats have always been the party of civil rights and human rights and women. She will claim the historic mantle of being a historic first. I mean, I think it is, she will be kind of a historic first. We've never had a female mob boss run this country, so she would be a historic first. No, we'll hear the usual dog and pony show, and our movie actually directly contradicts it. So I'm looking forward to Hillary. She's going to give you the official story, and then Hillary's America is going to give the real story. Yes.
Trevor Wiegert, University of Nebraska, Kearney. I guess as a future history teacher, I found all this super riveting and interesting. I guess my question is, do you see this trend in the education system ever changing back to a more, I guess, true historical narrative? And if so, like, are there any specific educational policies you would advocate in order to see that change in public education?
30 years ago, as progressives dominated the universities, conservatives had almost no response, because it's not enough to send Dinesh to campus because I speak on Monday, I leave on Tuesday. The professors live there. We'd have to start 300 campuses to rival the domination of the left. The beauty today is because of technology and because of other means of delivering information, movies being one of them, the disinfectant of truth and facts is crushing. Because in some ways, precisely because the left has been hiding so much and sweeping it under the rug, that's what gives emotional power to my movie. Imagine if everybody already knew this stuff. They'd be like, ho-hum, tell us something we don't know. The reason I can tell you something you don't know is that it's been kept from you. And once it's out there, it's kind of a challenge. I've put down the gauntlet. Okay, if I'm wrong, show me. And I'm still waiting. And I'll be waiting a long time from now. So today, facts are very powerful, but we have to creatively deploy them. If I just wrote it in an op-ed, no one would see it. But by sticking it on 1,200 screens around the country, it's a little hard to ignore.
Thank you.
Okay?
Hi, my name is Doyle Wang. I'm a rising freshman at Hillsdale College. And my question was based on not so long ago, my home state of Georgia became a Republican tilting state as a result of some conservative Democrats in my state switching to the Republican Party, which a seal which solidified Republican control of the state legislature. Now, the left still uses that party switching as a result of Republicans being racist. How can we refute that?
The refutation is in a book by Byron Schaefer and Richard Johnston called The End of Southern Exceptionalism. Mm-hmm. It actually looks to see, it divides the South into the most racist people and the non-racist. And it shows that the most racist people never switched. In fact, they felt comfortable staying in the Democratic Party. The non-racists in the South moved over to the Republican Party because of economic opportunity. Remember that racism was a technique to provide psychic consolation to the poor white man. It was a way of saying to the poor white man, your life sucks, but the good news is you belong to this exclusive club called For Whites Only. So that even though you're unbelievably stupid and you're unbelievably unsuccessful, we are still going to put you on a totem pole that is higher than the most educated black man. This was Democratic Party political strategy for more than half a century in the 20th century. That's why the Democrats held the poor whites. That's why the poor whites never left the Democratic Party. So it's important to fight this big switch nonsense because it's the last out for the left. But there is no out because the evidence is the other way. And it's important for you to be familiar with. So get the Byron Schaefer, Richard Johnston book. Get my book. Together, the two are kind of like one of those Muhammad Ali 1-2 punches.
Oh, thank you.
Be really helpful. Thank yes.
Hi, I'm Diego Rebelar here from George Washington University. And with the whole email scandal and the FBI declining to recommend indictment against Crooked Hillary, it seems as the system is rigged. So my question is, what can we do specifically to get back to the rule of law?
Number one, you have to expose the kernel of what's going on. I mean, look what these recent scandals show. Number one, the Democrats, the party called Democrats, are rigging their own elections. Unbelievable. They're running a Soviet-style election in America. Right? Amazing. Number two, when you listen to the private conversation of Democrats, you realize that the party of racism hasn't changed all that much. Their Hispanic initiative, they call it the Taco Bell initiative. They make all kinds of fun of blacks, homosexuals. They want to use Bernie Sanders' alleged atheism against him. This is the party in its actual private, you may say, uncensored speech. And so imagine, if this was Trump and the Republicans, the media would be so all over this. As it is, it's once again a progressive embarrassment that the people at NPR, the people at ABC, CBS, the New York Times, they view their job. This is their job. How do we cover it up? How do we minimize it? We can't deny it. But how do we make it a no big deal? How do we make it kind of a let's move on? This is how these people think. That's why it's very important for you as young people to think, how can I influence the institutions of media, Hollywood, comedy, and academia? Because we can't allow the left to continue its current monopoly in those areas.
Thank you.
Yes.
Hello, my name is Merlina Haddad, and I'm from Connecticut. I recently saw your movie, Hillary's America, and it was amazing. But one of the questions that came to mind when I was watching it was, how did you do this? You know, most of the movies in theaters, everything in Hollywood has a bias, a liberal bias. So my question really is, was there any resistance from the Democratic side, from the government, when getting your movie in theaters? You know, I mean, you really did expose the true side of the Democratic Party and the evils that they do.
So the left, it was a pleasant discovery for me that the left controls Hollywood, which is movie production, but it doesn't control movie distribution. The movie distribution is completely different. So by allying ourselves with the distributors, i.e. the people who own Regal, Cinemark, AMC, the big theater chains, I went to them and they said, look, Dinesh, if you can get people lined up along the block, we're happy to put your movie in our theaters. And that's all I needed to hear. So we're not part of Hollywood. We film this whole movie in Dallas. And this keeps us outside the influence of Hollywood people to be able to torpedo us. Now, the moment the movie comes out, 300 critics are deployed to destroy it. And they'll go and they will absolutely trash the movie. Now, happily, most of these people are sort of ignoramuses. They're full of bile and hatred, but they don't know anything. So fighting against me is actually, 300 to 1 is pretty good odds for me, just in terms of knowledge. I'm not saying there aren't progressives who are smart. Believe me, they will ultimately deploy powerful historians from Bryn Mawr and Harvard and Stanford to go after the movie and the book. And I'm ready for that. But the point is, in the beginning, it's all these ridiculous people writing out of Greenwich Village and so on, and they're just sort of, they just come up with really big words that impress themselves and so on. So we'll get 5% in Rotten Tomatoes, but then we'll get 90% from the audiences. Audiences love the movie. And so the effort to block this movie has not worked. It isn't working. And I think we've shown a path that other conservatives can follow. The important thing to realize about movies is you don't make movies to do messaging. You make movies to entertain. Michael Moore knows this. It's one of the few things he does know. People go to the movies for fun. You make an entertaining movie, you can do a lot of messaging. You try to make a movie, people always saying to me, make a movie on Obamacare, make a movie on immigration. No, you have to make a movie that is a storyline, that actually has drama, that has plot, narrative, character, suspense. This movie's a thriller, because Hillary's involved, there are elements of horror. It's a little bit of a horror movie. But we don't leave people depressed.
Hi, my name is Austin Stevens. I'm from Coastal Carolina University. I was just wondering if you see a bright future for attracting more minorities to the Republican Party, back into the Republican Party. How do you see that happening, if so?
The two things are going on. One is, minorities, and particularly blacks, have been sold a storyline. The storyline is the Republican Party is the party of bigotry. So it's important to correct that perception. Show the Republican Party is actually the party of emancipation, anti-lynching, anti-segregation. The Republican Party has actually fought for immigrants and for blacks and for other minorities for the vast majority of its history. Number two, the way that the Democrats hold blacks, I thought of myself when I came at the age of 17 to America. You feel a sense of vertigo when you come to a new country. It's scary. You don't know anyone. You have no family, no credit. You're making your way in a new land. So the Republican Party says, climb up the ladder of opportunity. But you don't know how to climb. You don't know where that ladder even is. And then the Democrats come to you and say, listen, you don't need a ladder. We are standing on the top of the building. We'll let down a rope. You hang on to the rope. Hanging on is easier than climbing. We'll pull you up. And the thing that blacks and Hispanics and immigrants don't realize is the Democrats have no intention of pulling you all the way up. Their idea is to pull you a little way up and hold, and hold. Why? Because then you are suspended in permanent dependency. If you actually climbed up, you'd scramble, dust off your feet, and walk off. They can't have that. They've got to have it where you are subordinate to them, where you're dependent on the rope, where you know that if they let go, down they go. And that keeps them tied to the Democratic Party. It's a new form of servitude that's going on in America, except it's a much subtler form of servitude than the good old thrash them and keep them down in the plantation approach of the old Democratic Party. We need to expose the urban plantation. And that's where you strip away the moral capital of the progressive Democrats. Yes, sir.
Good morning, Dinesh. It's an honor to have you speaking here at this convention. I just was hoping that maybe you could elaborate a little bit more about your experience, you know, when you were imprisoned and essentially by the left being so vocal as you are, and how that impacted your view of progressivism in the left.
Well, prison is, I wasn't in real prison, I was in this confinement center, but it was kind of prison. And you see, first of all, even as a conservative, it makes you open your eyes. Because I'm very up on America, but I'm not so up on the way things are done by a government. If you had asked me when I was young that 95% of all people accused of a federal crime plead guilty, I would have said, yeah, that's because most of them did it. That's why they plead guilty. The government is right to go after them. Now that I know more, I realize that's not the case. The government has ways of making innocent people plead guilty. It's unbelievable. Essentially, it's the plea bargain system. They come to a doctor. Let's say they want to get a doctor. He's done nothing wrong. Our federal statutes are so voluminous and accordion-like that they can find something, if not from your tax return. They'll find something like, didn't you administer pain medicine to Mrs. Smith? We're going to charge you with the illegal administration of illegal drugs. And you say, but she was in pain. I'm a doctor. They go, I know, but you exceeded the allowable dose of pain medicine. We're going to charge you with a crime that will put you away for 5 years. But if you plead guilty, you'll get 3 months, and you can practice medicine again. So what's your choice? Ruin your entire life, be known as a federal criminal, be locked up for 5 years and destroy your relationships with your friends, undermine your family, or take a plea. This is the strong arm tactic that is routinely used. So I used to believe, you know, better that 9 guilty men go free than 1 innocent person be locked up. I honestly believe lots of innocent people are being locked up, and they are locked up right now. So it clears your mind of a dewy-eyed view of the way the world is. It's true that countries like Venezuela, where my wife grew up, or me, India, our countries are run by gangs. And we like to believe it's totally different here. It is different, but it's not totally different. So these experiences are eye-opening for me. I think it's given my conservatism a grittier, which is to say a more solid foundation. Guys, thank you for your attention. See the movie. It's a secret of movies that the fate of a movie depends on how the movie does in the opening couple of weeks. If a movie does well at the beginning, it spreads out. People say, how do I get your movie seen by Independence? You want to know how? Go see it this week or this coming weekend. Because if you see it now, you're putting fuel into our rocket. Part of what you should learn to do is use your influence. Most of us use very little of our actual influence. You say, well, I only have 300 friends on Facebook. Yeah, but they've got 300 friends on Facebook. So today you're like a little publisher. And if you use your influence to get information out, you're actually able to change the way that people think. The beauty of a movie, you can watch a movie in 90 minutes, and it changes you a little on the inside. Movies have the power to do that. And books have a power to change minds by providing information, and information in our era is power. So once again, I urge you to be not apathetic, but be very dangerous Americans. And go out there and change society and help save your country. Thank you very much.